time for bureaucrats in Wellington to decide which groups are the most worthy and who's truly in need. Those decisions must come from within community boundaries, from those people dealing every day and asking for help, from those that they know and trust. In many ways, this is a break away from the tradition of how government funds the social services sector. But to me, it seems the most practical. How is it that in Gore, a community of just 12,000 people, at any one stage had more than 84 agencies trying to work with its families? All funded from the same pot. That just doesn't make sense to me. If government is pouring money into the same groups which are trying to work with the same people to achieve the same results, I'm just not convinced it's the best use of your money. Over the past decade, some in the sector, with what I'm sure are the best of intentions, have become adept at second-guessing government priorities and adapting to suit, securing funding in the process. They learn to write perfect applications and jump through the necessary hoops. They learn that if they ticked all the right boxes, they would guarantee government funding year after year. The model of pathway to partnership ran the risk of government becoming a crutch without which providers couldn't walk down a path at all. In many ways, for me, it raised more questions than it answered. The biggest was, how will full funding work in practice? And how beholden are you then to the government of the day? Limiting this to essential services also cut out the ability for community-led innovation. I know of a social service provider in a small town which has run an exceptional program for young adults with disabilities for the last 2 years. It saw a need that wasn't being met in the local community and filled it. It's being funded through a mix of philanthropy and local government money and wants a bit of help from central government to help it expand. The organisation isn't asking to be fully funded by central government, but under the pathway to partnership model, that's what it could reasonably have expected. Now, it may be exactly what the provider deserves, yeah? But in today's world, it means cutting a service somewhere else. Now, I know I'm digressing a bit here, but I'd like to explain the long-term thinking that's needed, the challenges this government faces, and the conversation we need to have. A move to full funding with no real assessment of what's actually needed on the ground in our communities creates a risk of dependency, which is really hard to move away from. And who could blame those groups? If you're providing a service which people benefit from and getting the funding year after year, where's the backwards look to check that you haven't deviated from your course and you're still going in the right direction? Where's the check the work being done is still benefiting the right group of people, the right families, the right children? Full funding creates expectations, and expectations can actually be restrictive and stifle innovation. And this is simply not the time for complacency, particularly when the money available needs to be spent on a greater number of people to the greatest benefit. As we entered into budget negotiations this year, the scale of the economic crisis facing us was beginning to be more fully understood. As the year progresses, it was becoming clearer that as a country, we have an uphill battle ahead of us. We need to do more with less. We're not even looking at being in surplus for at least another decade. There are currently 310,000 people receiving a benefit in this country. The number of people requiring an unemployment benefit is forecast to rise to over 80,000 over summer. The amount spent on benefits is expected to increase by over $1 billion a year over the next 3 years. But despite the very real pressures being put on the government's resources, I've been pleased to be able to deliver a commitment that the money allocated to Pathway to Partnership would not be lost. Yeah? It will remain in the sector. I just want to repeat that. So that Pathways to Partnership money will remain in the sector. And that's a huge win in this economic climate. But as previously signalled, how we use that money will have to change. I know many of you will be thinking, you know, so what does that really mean? Well, it means that we need to think harder and smarter about how best to deliver these services to the people who need it most. And there is no doubt in my mind that there are people who need our support more now than ever. However, I don't feel it's up to this government to say which organisations should be supporting them. When I announced the Community Response Fund, I said I hoped it would generate a great deal of self-examination by those working in the sector, that I hoped they would take a look at the services available within various communities, work out where there was a duplication of services or a crossover, and work together to fix it to the benefit of the people that they serve. I was quite serious about that. Make no mistake, New Zealand faces a crisis, and this is not the time to get cute or play politics with funding. What works deserves to be and will be backed to the hilt by myself and this government. But if I'm going to make a case for the sector in future budgets in recessionary times, I need to, hand on heart, tell the Minister of Finance the sector is doing the best possible job it can to make its funding go further. Because we need to start thinking about how government and the sector can work together once this crisis has passed. I know we can work together very efficiently. This was demonstrated ahead of the announcement on the Community Response Fund, and I'm keen to maintain and actually build on working that relationship a lot further. But I equally want to make it very clear that I don't believe it's the job of government to decide what works best and what needs to change. That must come from within the sector and within our communities. Although that doesn't mean I won't challenge you from time to time, as I'm sure that some of you will be aware. I will also acknowledge that government could be more efficient in how it administers its contracts with third-party providers of social services. I'm hoping to give you greater detail on this later in the year. If we can get this right, we will have effected enormous change. Believe me, I'm fully aware of what I'm asking. I'm laying down a challenge to you to start thinking past permanent government top-ups to a world where communities drive their own solutions. And in some communities, I know this is already happening. But now it's time to put the pedal to the metal and accelerate that process. I'd ask those who work in the sector to think about how beneficial it will be to the people they're actually working with. By working together, by aligning and combining resources, by identifying those families who need the most help, I believe the best possible service will be delivered. And you know better than the rest of New Zealand how vital it is to get it right. That's because you're called in to sort out the mess when things go wrong. You know, sometimes there are figures which literally stop me in my tracks in this job, and here's one of them. Police estimate they see 65,000 children in domestic violence incidences each year. 65,000. So once you get your head around how truly horrific that number is, something worse occurs to me. How many more children are actually experiencing domestic violence incidences that the police don't see? And how many children are actually going uncounted? You know, I've talked at length so far about the vital work being done out there by the social services groups in dealing with vulnerable families who are at breaking point. These children have been very patient for me. But to me, that's not enough. I think society has become very good at pulling down the shutters. How many people out there truly know what's happening in their neighbourhood? What's happening two doors down from where they live? We're all responsible for the children in our communities. As the old saying goes, it takes a village to raise a child. Every single person who comes in contact with a child has an effect, good or bad. Each person who comes into contact with a child has an opportunity to listen, to observe, to notice, and if necessary, to take action on behalf of that child. Saliel and Olympia Acklin, you know, Narcelia Whitaker, James Whakaruru, Mia Glassy, you know, sadly the names change, but the disturbing themes of traumatic lives remain the same. While many are clearly let down by their caregivers, I often wonder how many other adults in their lives just turned a blind eye. When we hold the belief that other people's children are none of our business because we're afraid, because we don't want to get involved, because we're not sure, even though our gut tells us something is wrong, it is the child who suffers the most. Other people's children are our business, and the children of New Zealand belong to the whole country. The theme you've selected for this conference is a powerful one. You're brainstorming ideas that will inspire and connect people within communities to think as a village in raising our children. And even better, you're undertaking this work from a solid foundation of experience out there in the community, working with children, families and organisations. You know, in the past I've made comments that all children are our children, the healthy, the unhealthy, the poor, the rich, the naughty and the good. You know, and I've been criticised by some for wanting to interfere. Yeah? Actually, those critics miss the point completely. I'm not interested in going into the homes of New Zealanders and telling them how to parent. But I will not sit back while thousands of our children are abused and neglected. What upsets me is the only time we get outraged enough about this is when it hits the media. It is a sad reflection on our society that a child will be severely abused or even die in the next few weeks at the hands of someone who is supposed to care for and love them. The only difference between the horrific life led by that child and those led by some of the children you know is whether a full scale of that horror is played out in the media headlines. As you well know, for every case that hits the headlines, there are many more living the same quiet lives of desperation. There is no question that it happens, but you can stop this all on your own. You can't stop this all on your own, and neither should you. Right now, there are just over 40 child advocates working up and down the country. If we truly believe as a country that it takes a village to raise a child, then that means that every single one of us becomes a child advocate. Each and every one of us listens to what children say and will respond to this with appropriate action. As child advocates within the community, you are modelling this way to be and behave and therefore encouraging other people to be child advocates as well. I have great respect and admiration for the work that you are doing. In fact, I feel really humbled by it. But, you know, I sit up there in that beehive and make decisions and things. I just completely admire that you're on the ground and doing the work that you are doing. I'm really excited to see what ideas and concepts may come out of this conference. Please share them with me. I believe that you've made a very powerful choice of things. It's our job as adults, as organisations, as people in positions of comparative power to look after the needs of our children, of all of our children. I wish you well, and I thank you for the opportunity to come down and share my thoughts and where we're at the moment. All the best with your conference over the next 2 months.
Thank you.
I'd just like to thank you very much, Minister.